book of Philippians, amen. Paul spoke about keeping his eye on the prize.
Yeah.
Look at somebody and say, keep your eye on the prize. Now, I need a good reader this morning, amen. Somebody that would read for me Philippians from the third chapter, verses 13 and 14. And there's a real message here, amen, because for those that are looking for it, amen, I'm going to give you a moment to find that, amen, Philippians, the New Testament, the third chapter, verses 13 and 14. Amen. And we really do need to keep our eye on the prize. Amen. I remember when I was growing up, as you were searching for the book of Philippians, amen. As we were growing up, amen, praise God, there was always, and I think they probably still have them, amen. We used to go out, amen, and get what they call Cracker Jacks. Anybody know what I'm talking about here? Amen. Cracker Jacks, amen. I was happy to be over at the Dollar General on the other day. Happy Holy Ghost. On the other day, amen. And I looked up and they had there three boxes of Cracker Jacks. I said, Lord, I haven't seen these since I was a youth. Amen. But Cracker Jacks. And my mother would always go out, amen. We thought that was the best thing you can get. Get some Cracker Jacks. And they had three boxes of them. I would hide them underneath the bed, amen. I didn't want any, Lord help us today. Didn't want to get mine. But the thing about the Cracker Jacks, I wasn't so happy about the Cracker Jacks themselves. Yeah, right, I was looking for the prize. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Amen. It wasn't so much that the Cracker Jack was so good, it was the prize in the box.
Yeah, yeah.
Lord have mercy. Keep, I hope somebody can see what I'm seeing
yeah,
today.
Yeah, uh-huh.
Amen. It was the prize that was in the box. Amen. And I would get excited, amen, because I didn't know what was coming up.
Yeah.
Amen. And I was just praying it wasn't something that I already had from the last time she had went and got groceries. Amen. It was in those days they got groceries. Amen. So, but I was looking for the prize. And I thought about Paul here, amen. Paul said, listen, I'm going to keep my eye on the prize. Yeah. How many of you know it's about the prize?
Yeah.
I don't know about you, amen. And when I was dating my wife, amen, help us you hold the dose. Amen. I was looking for a prize. Amen. And I didn't just want any prize. I didn't just want anybody. Amen. You know what I'm saying, right?
Yes, yes.
Amen. You want to make sure that whatever you get is spectacular. Am I right about it?
Amen.
Amen. So you want to take your time, amen, and make sure what you're receiving is exactly what you are expecting. Somebody said you got to expect something.
Expect something.
Amen. So I think that reader, amen, Philippians, the third chapter, 13 to 14.
Brethren, I have not myself to have apprehended.
Yes.
But this one thing I do.
Yes.
Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before.
That's right.
I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus.
Hallelujah. That's a strong reader. Amen. So Paul, amen, in these words, amen, said, I count not myself to have apprehended. So Paul is saying right here, listen, I may not be the most spectacular person that there is. And so listen, don't get confused. I may have not really apprehended or really understood. But for one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, I'm not going to worry about the things that are already passed. I can't do anything. I can't do nothing about them. But guess what? Amen. Which are behind me, so I'm reaching forth unto the things which are before. So Paul, amen, had an imagination. Listen, I'm looking for something that's going to deliver me, take me through the promised land. So I'm looking for the prize. The things that had happened before, I'm not going to worry about them, amen, because I can't do anything about them. So the problem that happens many times, we're always worrying, amen, concerned about what has happened. Forget about what has happened. Look for the things that are coming before. And that's what Paul is trying to tell us here on today. He said, I press toward the mark for the prize, the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Watch this. An alternate translation says, listen, I'm not saying that I have this all together. Paul said, I don't think that I have it all together. Amen. That I've made it, but I am well on my way. Amen. Reaching out for Christ, who has so wonderfully reached out to me. Don't you know that God is reaching out to you? Amen. Friend, do not get me wrong, but no, by no means do I count myself an enemy. expert in all of this, but I have my eye on the goal. Help me, Holy Ghost. Well, God is beckoning unto us, amen. I'm off and running, and I'm not turning back. Amen. Look at somebody and say, I'm not turning back. So let's keep the focus on the goal, amen. Those of us who want everything God has for us, if any of you have something else in mind, something less than total commitment, because God is requiring total commitment, amen. Help me, Holy Ghost. Amen. Anything other than total commitment, God will clear, amen, your vision, amen. You will see it, amen. You may not see it yet. Not that you're on the right track, amen. Let us continue to run the race. Amen. Nobody starting in a race, amen, want to come in second place, third place, amen, because the prize is really given to the first place winner. Amen. Now we salute, amen, the second place and third place, but if you come in anywhere but low fourth place, amen, amen, then I'm counting it. Am I right about it? Look at somebody that keep running the race.
Keep running the race.
Keep your eye on the prize. Amen. So today we're going to see from this scripture, amen, that life is a race to be run. Amen. Now I realize that you may not feel like running on this morning, amen, this early in the morning, but in fact, some of you, amen, may not even feel like running at all. Help me, Holy Ghost. But the type of running that I'm going to talk about today does not involve cardiovascular exercise. Not going to give you, amen, aching feet, amen. Instead, it gets us to where we are to be spiritually in the Lord. Amen. God wants us to be prepared, amen. And in order for someone to run a race, amen, you have to get yourself in good physical condition.
Okay.
Am I right about it?
Amen.
You got to get yourself in good physical condition. Somebody may have to go out to the gym, amen. Somebody may have to walk the track in the morning, amen. Somebody may have to get up and do some calisthenics, amen. Or do some exercise, or do some stretching, or some of those things, amen. Help me, Holy Ghost. Amen. I remember, amen, my wife, when she was getting, since she was getting herself in shape, amen, we went out and bought all types of equipment, help me, Holy Ghost. All kinds of equipment, amen. We got everything that you can think of. Treadmills, amen. All of these type things that you can get, amen. Bicycles, amen. We had it all, amen. And so many stuff that was tripping over it. Help me, Holy Ghost. But she was determined, amen, to meet her goal, amen. She had a goal in mind. Help me, Holy Ghost. And she was trying to get there. And she had all of the tools and all of the equipment, amen, to seemingly, help me, Holy Ghost, get to the place in which she was going to get. But I must remind you of one thing, amen. You can get all the equipment and all of the exercise and all of those things that you're going to do, but at some point in time, you're going to have to use it.
Amen.
Am I right about it?
Amen.
Now, she started out real well. Amen. She was on it, amen. Had the towels. She had all of the things. Bought all of the outfits. Bought all of the outfits and everything else. All, you know what I'm talking about, right? Amen. The barbells and all of those things. Amen. Because it's good to have the equipment, but help me, Holy Ghost. It's good to have the equipment, but you must be able to use it. Am I right about it? And that's what I'm saying. We've got to begin to prepare ourselves, amen, to win this race. Amen. The race is not given to the swift, nor to the strong, but those that endure to the end. Help me, Holy Ghost. And I know, amen, it's at this time of year we begin to start thinking about, amen, the year coming to a close, amen, and many of you begin to start thinking about New Year's resolutions, amen, and that's some of the things in which, amen, we have in our mind, amen. Some of us, amen, are going to begin to go out and buy all types of equipment, amen, expecting, amen, to reach the goal, amen, but many of us, amen, start out, amen, on the track, amen, but we just never finish the race. But I need some people that are looking to finish the race. God is calling for some people, amen, that are going to put the mileage, amen, want to work, amen, toward the goal to get to the high part, amen. You want to finish the race, amen. You want to hit the track in the morning, amen. I'm going to hit the track running. God looking for some people that want to hit the track, amen. Amen. You're looking for a deliverance. You're looking for God to drop something in your spirit. But you got to start out on the track.
Amen.
Clap your hands for the Lord. Amen. So, but this type of running that we're talking about today, amen, does not involve this type of exercise. exercise. Speaking of exercise, I reminded you of a story. Amen. A retired couple who decided that they should walk 2 miles a day to stay in shape. How many of you know that walking will keep you in shape?
Amen.
All right. Amen. Praise God. They chose to walk a mile. Amen. Out on a lonely country road, the story writers had it. So they would have no choice but to walk back. So you got to watch the story here. And at the 1 mile mark on their first venture, the man asked his wife, he said, "Honey, do you think that you can make it back all right? Or are you too tired?" She said, "Oh no," she said, "I'm not tired. I can make it just fine." He said, "That's good. I'll wait here. You go back, get the car, and come back and get me." Lord help us. So he had some good determination, amen. Lord help us, but you see, Lord help us here today. So let us look again at our text, amen. Walk with me here. Paul said, "Brother, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward unto things which are before. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." Bear with me for a moment as I set the context of what is taking place in the letter to the Philippian church. Amen. We see here in Philippians 3, Paul giving us the spiritual biography. That may hold those. If we look back, we see Paul describing his past. Amen. In verses 1 and 11, amen, his presence, amen, which we will examine more closely in our text. Paul, amen, has a determination. He's looking for God to deliver him, looking for God to get him across the finish line, but he realized that I got to keep my eye on the prize. I can't hold back, amen. I can't take down. I got to keep on pressing. I need to make sure y'all get this, amen. You see, although Paul was a spiritual giant in the eyes of the Philippians, amen, saints, he wanted them to know that he had not yet attained the goal stated in verse 12. Well, let's back up real quickly. Take a look at the goal. Amen. Goal 1. He said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. Now, I want you to know that God suffered. Amen. And if you're going to reign with him, he said that you're going to have to suffer. Lord help us today. You're going to have to suffer with him. Amen. So that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made comfortable unto his death. Go to, if by any means I might obtain unto the resurrection of death. And finally, goal 3, he said, not as though I have already obtained, either we are already perfect, I apprehend, for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. So Paul is saying, brother, I count not myself to have apprehended. Listen, I'm not an expert on this subject, in other words, as Paul is saying. But listen, I'm a student, amen, just trying to make an A grade. How many of you are just trying to make an A grade on today? We see here that Paul was still active and pressing on toward the prize of the high calling. But all that he had accomplished, you know, Paul was very accomplished. He was a great writer, amen. He was highly respected, amen. He was not ready to sit back, amen, then kick up his feet, amen, and chill for the remainder of his life. Paul knew, amen, that he had to shift in the atmosphere if anything was going to happen. Amen. With all that he had accomplished, he was not ready, amen, to take down. And he knew that he still had some running to do. Amen. Sometimes just because we have made it to the place where we are today, we still have a ways to go. Am I right about it? So Paul knew he still had some running to do. He knew that he by no means had reached the finish line. He knew that if he wanted to make it, he had to keep his eyes on the finish line. In other words, keep his eyes on the prize. He knew that he still had to run. Amen. He couldn't take down in the middle of the race. Now let us put a pin right here and deal with this for a minute. If any human being, praise God, have a right to brag or to get high-minded about their status. You know how people get sometimes about their status. Amen. You got to address them properly. Help me, Holy Ghost. Amen. You got to make sure that Mr. Elder, bishop, prophet, whatever it may be, just call me brother. I'm all right with that. Amen. But some people, you got to be very careful how you deal with them and how you address them. So Paul had a right to brag. Am I right about it? He wasn't high-minded about his status, his position in society. It could have been just Brother Paul, I believe. Amen. And oh yeah, just think about it for a second. He is responsible for 13 of the 27 books of the New Testament. I think he had been working. Amen. In fact, we can look at his life and his qualifications speaks for themselves. Philippians 3 and 5 says he names off his credentials. Amen. One, he was circumcised on the eighth day. Amen. Number two, he was the stock of Israel. Help me, Holy Ghost. Amen. He was of the tribe of Benjamin. Amen. He was a Hebrew of the Hebrews. Amen. I'm talking about Paul still yet. Amen. He was very pressed in the law. Amen. In other words, he knew the law. Amen. He didn't have to go back and look through books. Amen. He was one of the best at the law. He was a Pharisee. Amen. You can see he had some very strong credentials. Are you praying for me? But wait, that's not all. Amen. Over in 2 Corinthians, amen, in the 11th chapter, in the 24th through the 28th verse, he gives us a few more of his credentials. Amen. You know how we are. You know, we got a master's in this. Amen. You know, heaven and Holy Ghost. We got a doctorate in this. You know, we're philosophers. Amen. But Paul, amen, he had worked much harder. He had been jailed, amen, more often than anybody else. He was beaten more time than I can count. Amen. And at death door, time after time, again, Paul was still carrying the gospel of Jesus in spite of what people were saying. Amen. Paul was still standing up for the Lord. Amen. He was flogged 5 times. Amen. With the Jews, he received 39 lashes. Beaten by the Roman rod 3 times. Plummeted by rocks. Amen. Been shipwrecked 3 times. Amen. Help me, Holy Ghost. Because Paul was determined he had to make the goal. Amen. He had to achieve the prize. Amen. And in the midst in the open sea, night and day, Paul, amen, really endured hardship like a good soldier. He said, I had hard traveling year in and year out. He fended off robbers. Amen. How many know what I'm talking about? He struggled with his friends. Amen. Struggled with foes. He made up risk in the city, risk in the country. But that didn't stop Paul. He kept on pressing on. You know, many of us, if we had had the trouble that Paul had, I think we would have taken down. Amen. We would have turned back and went a different direction. But Paul continued because he knew that the Lord Jesus, amen, was on his side. You know that God was a deliverer. You know that God was going to get him out of the trouble, out of the turmoil that he was in. Somebody say amen. Amen. Paul was in danger, amen, by the desert sun and the sea storms, and betrayed by those, amen, and Saul was his brother. You know how it is sometimes. There are some people, amen, that are going with you, walking with you, but sometimes along the way, they fall off, amen. And sometimes it's good that some of those people that fell off, amen, you need to leave them where they are. Because everybody that say yes, brother, and amen, along with it, not everybody's for you. Amen. Sometimes I want you to know that you got to watch the circle in which you travel in. Everybody, amen, that's patting you on the back, that's not always your friend. They're not always saying good things about you. Heavenly Holy Ghost. You got to watch the circle in which you're traveling in. But I'm still talking about Paul. He missed many meals. Amen. Blasted by the cold. Naked in the weather. But with all of this credentials, and although he had won many spiritual battles, in that time he had grown much in those years. But his canon is confessed in Paul in verse 13. He said, I count not myself to have apprehended. Oh, what humility. You see that Apostle Paul, he did not put confidence in his flesh. We got too many people today that are concerned about the flesh. You're worried about my family. You're not worried about the church. Some people don't have my word. I'm concerned about others. I like what Paul did. Paul said that I press to the mark of the high calling, which is in God in Christ Jesus. With all of those accolades, I thank Paul because he stood for something. I heard my grandmother say that if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. Somebody say amen. Savior. It's the most important thing that I ever should know. I thank Jesus because he brought me out of trouble. He brought me out of my trials. He lifted me out of my turmoil. Jesus, he's my great maker. He's my deliverer. Somebody shout Jesus. Jesus, Lord help us today. I'll never cease to amaze me. God's so good to me. He's so good to you. He's a deliverer. He's your all in all. Somebody say thank you, Jesus, for what you've done. I thank you, Jesus, for who you are today. You're a way maker. You're a word bearer. Heaven knows sharer. Thank you, Lord. Now watch this. Paul goes on to say in verse 8, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung that I may win Christ. You see, Paul kept his mind on the prize. He knew that if he wanted to get there, he wasn't going to get there without Jesus. You know, many times we travel these roads, amen, and sometimes there used to be an old songwriter, I know Mother Otto knew it, the songwriter used to say, take Jesus along with you everywhere you go. The old people say, you're going to need him, you're going to need him everywhere you go. Lord, help us all today. I don't know about you today, but I'm taking Jesus everywhere I go. Watch this. Ephesians 2:8-9 says, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not a worse lest any man should boast. Amen. And I'm going to finish it in about 10 minutes. Amen. For by grace ye are saved through faith. Listen, you got to have this. God gave every man a measure of faith.
Amen.
So this testimony of the Apostle Paul, amen, reminds the saints at Philippi, amen, and should serve notice to us this morning that there must never be a stalemate in our spiritual growth, amen, or a plateau beyond which we cannot climb. God, amen, has saved his life, amen, and we've struggled, amen. Many have had hardships in this life, amen, and we look at people, amen, sometimes look like they're not doing anything, they're not bound to anything, but they got all the things in which we are desiring, but don't worry about it, amen. You look like the people that, amen, that are out on the street corner doing all kinds of things, amen. Help me, Holy Ghost, amen. They are the ones that are still making it. They are the ones that are prospering, and you're wondering, what about me, Lord? Lord, I'm doing everything that you asked me to do, but why is the neighbor, Lord, that's out on the street corner selling drugs, doing better than I am? What about, Lord, those, Lord, help me, one of those in the workplace, corrupt, Lord, they're still doing better than I am. I stop by today to let you know that Jesus is the way. Don't worry about anybody else. Testimony of the Apostle Paul reminds the saints of Philippi, as you serve notice again this morning, that Jesus is still on the throne. Amen. Those of you that are familiar with the writing style of the Apostle Paul may have noticed that he often used everyday illustrations, amen, from the time in which he lived and communicated truth about the Christian life. For example, Paul said, put on the whole armor of God. Paul said that you are a temple of God. Don't you know that this temple, amen, cannot be corrupted? Amen. You've got to hold on. The old people would say, hold on to God's unchanging hand. Whatever man soweth, that shall he also reap. Amen. According to Galatians, amen. Paul said, brother, I count not myself to have apprehended. Look at somebody say, I count not myself to have apprehended. We have dealt with that. Now let us deal with this. But there's one thing I do. These are those who call this world we live in a rat race of life. Amen. As human, we get up, amen, we go to work, amen, we race around, we seek together all of the riches that seem to be around us. Some people in this life are motivated by power. Somebody say power. Power over others, amen. Power over self, to control rather than being controlled in these hearts, their heart desires. Others seek wealth above all else. Money, diamonds, precious materials, real estate. Satan. The more wealth they have, the more satisfied they become. Others run the race of beauty to satisfy their pride. Well, I hope you're praying with me today. In this reality TV-based generation in which we live, there are those who run for fame, amen. Those well-known and loved, all of those things have one thing in common. It's for a corruptible crown. Lord, help us today. A corruptible crown. I'm convinced that Christians are involved in many things that do not result in eternal rewards. Amen. You're looking for a eternal reward. Lord, help us today. When the secret of progress found here in verse 13 is to concentrate one thing. Amen. I'm convinced that Christians are involved in many things that do not result in eternal rewards. Yes, believe it or not, one thing is the phrase that's important to the Christian life. Jesus said to the rich young ruler, get this. Then Jesus, beholding, loved him and said to him, one thing thou likest, go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, and give to the poor. And thou shalt have treasures in heaven. And come up, take up that cross, and follow me. I want you to know today that God is not going to give you a burden that you cannot bear. You've heard it so much, a preacher, I've heard that many times. God is not going to give you too much that you can't bear. Listen, there's a story about a fellow that was in the crossroom. Lord, was here today. And he came into the crossroom, amen, and they had about 40 crosses across the store, amen. And he came in and he was complaining, amen. And he came in and bought one of the crosses, amen, and hooked himself up and got the cross on his back. You know, he wanted to be a follower of Jesus, so he wanted to see if he could carry his own cross. So he got the cross, he can put it on his back, amen, help me, Holy Ghost, amen. And they went out with it and they worked on it, or worked with it on his back all day. And he came back to the cross store and he spoke to the fellow and said, listen, you know, I like this cross, but it's a little bit too heavy for me. He said, I think I want to take it back and let's see what else you have in the store. And Mother Ollie, he shopped around and he took that cross and he took it back and placed it where he found it and got another cross that was a little bit smaller. He thought that maybe he could bear that cross and he put that cross on his back. Amen. He went out and he worked with it all day and he still wasn't satisfied. You know, how many of you know that sometimes God can give us all that we have and sometimes we're still not satisfied. Amen. So he took that cross, Brother Solomon, and he put it on his back and he worked with it all day and he came back again complaining and murmuring because the cross, while it looks smaller, he said it looks smaller, but I think it's got a lot of metal in it and it's too heavy. So the fellow said, well, what can I do for you? I got 40 more crosses over here. Well, what do you want? Well, what's good? He said, well, I'll tell you what. I'm going to put this one down. These two that you gave me, they're just not working. He said, I'm going to go get this one over here. I see this one over here in the corner. I like this one. So he went and he tried the other one on. He put it on and soldered it up. So that cross that you're receiving right now, that's the exact same cross that you had the first time. So sometimes, amen, God's not going to give you anything that he can't bear, too difficult. He picked up the exact same cross that he came in with. Lord, have us on today. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Everybody's close here. Amen. So I want you to know, amen, the moral of the story is eye on the prize. And I want you today to keep your eye on the prize, amen. I don't care what you're going through, amen, the burdens that you're bearing, amen, the trouble that you're seeing, amen. So the old song said, nobody know the trouble that I've seen. Amen. Many of us have gone through troubles, amen. We've had turmoil in our lives. Lives have been turned upside down. But I want you to know today that you got to keep your eye on the prize. John 9, 24 and 25, the story about a man who had received his sight by the power of God. Then again called the man that was blind and said to him, give God the praise. We know that this man, talking about Jesus, was a sinner. He answered and said, whether he's a sinner or not, I know not. One thing I know, whereas I was blind, now I see. I want you to know today, amen, that God will restore, amen, the thing that the cankerworm has taken away, God will restore those things to you if you continue to keep your eye on the prize. I mean, God is is trying to drill it, God is trying to drive it, amen, and we need to begin to accept it, amen. So this is what the one thing that the Apostle Paul is speaking of in the text today. The Apostle Paul said that the one thing is forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto things which are before. Now I know that some of you are saying that it's easy say that done, forgetting things that are behind. Well, I do not stand before you this morning saying that if you look back over your life, that you return into a pillar of salt, like Lot's wife. What I'm saying that if you wallow in your sorrows of the past, that you could hinder your outlook on the future. Don't wallow in the past, amen. Look to the future. There's brighter days ahead. What I'm saying that if you wallow in the sorrow of your past, that you can hinder the outlook of the future. Amen. And you're pressing your way. Amen. Looks like you can't see your way out. I'm telling you, just to hold on to Jesus. Amen. God is a way maker. Amen. He's done so many things. You got to look back and wonder, why am I even here today? Amen. The Lord could have cut it short. But I thank God for what he's doing. Amen. I thank God for what he has done. Amen. One writer said, never would have made it. Never would have made it without the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You know, there's some people that are going to tell you, amen, that you're never going to amount to anything. Help me, Holy Ghost. There's people who probably told some of you that today, amen. You're never going to make it, amen. But you didn't stop there. Amen. You kept on pressing. You kept on moving, amen. Look at somebody that keep on moving. If you keep on moving, that's what God's going to bring you out. If you get in trouble, amen, just keep on moving. Keep on praying. Keep on lifting. Keep on crying, because you cry out to the Lord late in the midnight hour. He'll deliver. He didn't say what time of the night. He just said at midnight. Paul and Silas were in prison, but at midnight there was a great earthquake. The shaking began to come on, and I saw Jesus begin to move in that place. He shaked loose the jail's keys. He shaked the ground that they were standing. Somebody. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.